land of 201 acres is quite good, and we have a consistently high ranking in the National Institute of the framework, ranking framework, NIRF. This year, overall ranking in 2020 is 29, and I think considering the fact that we are only in 2006, our ranking are very good. In fact, the only two institutions which are just ahead of us are IIT Hyderabad and ISAR Pune, which have come up at the same time. And in 2018, we were actually ranked 24. That was our highest ranking. And that year, we had the number one ISAR. And otherwise, we are currently at least number two. So I think we have been consistently ranked, and I'm sure this can actually increase further. I just wanted to tell, before I come to the science education, that what is chemistry? And it's very important to understand that the chemistry education is connected with physics, biology, just as physics, biology will be connected to chemistry, and mathematics becomes a tool to all these sciences. I'm going to talk about also COVID challenges and what are the opportunities that it throws in terms of science education, in particularly in terms of online learning. But first of all, since many of you are, I think almost all of you are science students, you must know why are you doing science, and that is very important. And the science that you do is to provide a basic expertise, an expertise of physics, chemistry, mathematics, biology, geology, etc. All these can provide a platform for this very cliche interdisciplinary research. It's a cliche, but believe me, today if you want to do research, particularly for translation, it's almost impossible to do keeping yourself in a single discipline, and that has been the problem in our country. You can, of course, go into academic research, you can go into teaching, you can go to industry, as many do. You can also follow lots of alternative science careers like journalism, reporting, communication, and so on. But very importantly, if you pursue science, you have freedom and fulfillment of mind. I think that is a very, very important part to realize. And that's one of the reasons that I took up science, was to have a free thought that you can do anything that you want, whatever is, whatever, wherever you can express yourself, you can do. There are lots of opportunities in science. As you are growing up, I must also show this. So obviously, after you do PhD, postdoctoral studies, etc., you can get an academic job in an institutions like IITs, institutions like us, ISARs, National Institute of Technologies, NITs. They also have, in fact, science departments. Then, of course, you have central, state universities, private universities, and many state as well as private colleges. So I think it's very important to realize this. We have, of course, research laboratories like the NIST Jorhat, like the NCL, where also you can do science, good, very good science. And today they also have a teaching component in terms of PhD. But the CSIR labs are mainly for research labs. And if you want to do a translational research, then these are the labs which give you, provide you among the best facility, the best ambience, the best environment. IISc Bangalore conventionally classified as a research lab, but today it has moved to the academic institution because it has an undergraduate program. Tata Institute of Fundamental Research has remained a research lab. Its sister concern, Homi Bhabha National Institute, goes into the academic institution. Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science, again, down here in Kolkata, is a very good research. It's actually the premier research laboratory in the country, and it has also started off late academic program. Then there are mission-driven research schemes that you can join. DAE, Department of Atomic Energy, ISRO, Space Research Organization, DRDO, which are defense organizations, and so on. Here, there are research which are specifically driven by a mission. So it's very important to realize that the teamwork towards a specific theme is very, very important, and not necessarily any kind of fundamental research. Then you have research which are done in industry, where industry is sponsored this. So these are called R&D industry. We have also entrepreneurship, which is called startup. So many of you, instead of looking for jobs, may actually start or create jobs by starting a startup company. And we would prefer that this should be science startup, which essentially means they should be they should have deep innovations. So what I call deep innovation. And I think this is something that is very, very important. Government is also putting a lot of money on startups. And I hope our science education will also have a component of startup entrepreneurship, how to become an entrepreneur. That's a very good course to be given. So if you do science, of course, you have opportunities for research. You can also do international collaboration and look at various countries, their ethics, culture, and so on. Let me first tell you how is fundamental science started. That's very important to realize that the fundamental science research cannot be often predicted. That is the problem. Most of us believe that this is curiosity-driven research. And in fact, basic research, we say curiosity-driven. And the most famous example actually is the Isaac Newton, who saw the apple falling, and then he started thinking, and then came the Newton's laws of motions. I think all of you know this story very well. The problem is that the apple was always falling, right? Apple fell downwards even before Isaac Newton. Did not anybody see that? We don't know. Or did anybody see, but did nobody could find a way to explain why does the apple fall downwards? Isaac Newton at least was the first to see and explain. And this is known as a very nicely known as a curiosity-driven research. But there are research which are accidental. And in fact, there are many examples. And one I can quote again from the chemistry is the synthesis of urea, which actually started the area of organic chemistry. Then there are research which comes out of necessity. One of the brilliant examples from the history is Archimedes, who all of you have heard the name of the Archimedes in Greece, who was actually challenged by the king Hero to find out if his goldsmith is cheating king by mixing silver. So he had to find the density, and to do that he had to find the volume, and eventually Archimedes found out the volume of an irregular substance. And all of you know the entire history, that he went in the streets shouting Eureka, Eureka. But one important point here is that in case he would not have done, why was he so excited? Not just because of the research, but probably the king Hero could have killed him. So I think that is very, very important to realize that this was a kind of a necessity for him to do the research. So it's very hard to predict how research comes. Research can come out of dream. Again, from chemistry, I can give one example, that is benzene. The benzene structure was found because Kekule dreamt of a snake seizing its own tail. So I think it's a very exciting time, because there is no very exciting field, because there is no way one can actually teach how to do research in science. You can only teach what are known, how to connect, but eventually original research is very hard to teach. And that is the reason many people who are very good students have not ended up being very good researchers. We have to understand that one can be very good student, but not necessarily at that excellent teacher. Let me first show this slide, and this is a very famous slide, where the x-axis is consideration of use. The y-axis is the quest for the fundamental understanding. So if you look at the bottom left quadrant, it has both low. So this is where you actually like to start. You would not like to be here, but this is where you start. And then there is a Bohr quadrant. Again, it is just paraphrased in the name of Niels Bohr, which is a high fundamental understanding, but low use. At least the use at that time was not understood. Then there is an Edison quadrant, which is a very high application, but low fundamental understanding. And then you have Louis Pasteur quadrant, which is called the use-inspired basic research, which is a high science, high application. Quite naturally, when you are starting here, we want to be here. We want to go here. The question is, how do you train people to go here? There is no way that the education can train people to do use-inspired basic research. And that is why I'm saying this integration of research with education is extremely important. Many people go up, do very fundamental science, but then they don't know how to come on the y-axis. So And many times it is because of their ego that they are very good fundamental scientists, they don't want to apply. There are people who do low science but good applications, and that could even include our innovations which come under the Juga. But again, for them also to go up in high science is also very difficult. So to do high science and then to make an application is the goal, and that is kind of paraphrased by Louis Pasteur, and that is what where it should be. So is it the way to go? Is it the way to go, or is there a simple way to go? And that is something the educators and the learners have to think together. I must tell, when we are talking about the Indian science, I must talk about the Nobel laureates, who are science Nobel laureates. Of course, I am not counting literature, economics, and so on, or peace. These are science Nobel laureates who are Indian or Indian origin. So we can only find four: Sir C.V. Raman, Arjavind Khurana, S. Chandrasekhar, and Venki Ramakrishnan. Out of which, actually, Sir C.V. Raman is the only one who got the Nobel Prize working in India. So this is something that one has to worry about. So the science in India has to catch up in terms of research, in terms of technology development, in terms of education. That is very important. All the three, we need to catch up with the Western world. But lest you forget, I must tell you that the ancient Indian science was quite developed. Although many of us who are aware of ancient Indian science are also aware that we have to think beyond that today and think more rationally. But let's not forget that there are inventions like zero, number theory, Ayurveda, even geometry, algebra, and I say even computer algorithms were developed in India much earlier than the modern. I have seen computer algorithms to solve equations like differential equations much earlier than the modern computer algorithms came. So I think it's very important to realize that the Indian science in ancient days was extremely developed, and somehow we lost it, and we had to rediscover the science in India. That is the reason we are organizing such programs. And I want to tell you why CSIR is interested in the science research training program, because the training that you get in the institutions is not enough. The training, and I'm going to paraphrase this even more, that the training requires a research component, and that is often not there. We understand during the COVID, it's very hard to do experimental research for you to come to the lab, see. So this is the best that one can do, is to bring people and educate you about research. When you are talking of science, we are talking of three different subjects, mainly three different subjects, okay, which are called natural sciences: chemistry, physics, biology. Of course, you have geology and so on, which are also natural sciences. As a chemist, I see a distinction of chemistry from physics and biology. And I want to tell you what is the distinction. You may or may not agree with me. So one of the important distinction is that as children grow up from after birth, they don't have any instinctive knowledge in chemistry. Chemistry is very complex to even understand later. But on the other hand, if you look at physics, you see that every day. A child plays with ball, with a balloon. As soon as the child is born, everything that the child does is governed by the laws of physics. A cricket ball, you see it, you feel it. Anything that you pick up, you have to put a force. So I think the physics is something that you see. You look at electricity, lights, you see it every day. Biology is, of course, a difficult subject, a complex subject, but you see plants, you see animals, you see biology, you see your own living thing that you are living, so there's a curiosity to understand. But in chemistry, it's not like that. You don't see molecules, you don't see atoms. So when somebody says you synthesize the molecule, you don't know what the person has synthesized, unless you go to some spectroscopy and all that. So chemistry is much more complex. So the way you learn chemistry is not that the people have an instinctive knowledge. It's only a transfer of knowledge. And in this process, there is a gap. Many times, the learners, like you, the students, fail to make sense of the teaching. or you even develop some alternative conceptions of the material that is presented. So I present something, you understand something else. Because the transfer of knowledge did not take place. There is a noise. There is a filter in which the knowledge was not transferred properly. Whereas in physics and biology, you have real things. You can always go and verify and ask questions. So according to me, that is why chemistry teaching has been much more difficult. And many students at the school level do not take interest in chemistry. Though chemistry is seen as a single discipline, but it has a very diversified approach. In fact, physical, organic, inorganic, I must say that it is very hard to believe, and this is a provocative statement, that most physical chemists are working within the same paradigm as most organic chemists. I believe the paradigm of the physical chemistry is quite different from the paradigm with which the organic chemists work. Perhaps you can say the same thing about the other subject, but somehow physics had a commonality of approach. Whether you go to electrodynamics or quantum mechanics or classical mechanics, there are some commonalities of approach. The phenomenology, theory trying to prove a phenomenology, use of mathematical tools, there are a lot. In biology, although it's a very broad, botany, zoology, but you can at least see them. But you need also to understand chemistry and physics. So there is a hierarchy of science, and I think I do not know, as a young people who are doing BSc and MSc, you will agree with the hierarchy. The hierarchy is not strict, but I must tell the hierarchy. For example, it is generally believed that if you are a good physicist, you must also know good mathematics. If you have to be a good physicist, mathematics is very important. I told you a commonality of physics uses mathematical tools. This is a provocative statement. I believe chemistry is also built on physics. Just as mathematics, chemistry is built on physics. Eventually, there is a physics approach. Biology, on the other hand, is built on chemistry, because biology has molecules which are working, and they are chemistry. On the other hand, the subject of psychology is actually built on biology, and so on. Although these are not very equivalent relationships. So for example, maths is a tool which is used heavily in physics, but it is also a tool used in chemistry and biology, as you'll see. Physics also relies on chemistry. It is not that chemistry only relies on physics. Like, you want to develop new material, you require understanding of chemistry. Psychology also builds heavily on biology, of course, but it also builds heavily on chemistry. And parts of psychology have nothing to do with physics, chemistry, biology. They can be called social sciences. They are not even called life sciences. So, of course, generally it is not true, or exactly it is not true, but this is the hierarchy which most people believe, that if you want to be a good psychologist, you should know good enough biology. For good enough biology, you must know a little bit of chemistry, and so on. Chemistry teaching has a very special problem, because it uses language. So you have to distinguish, and this is something I'm quoting from Jacob, you have to distinguish between chemical experiments and chemical language. And there are different levels of chemical language which exist. So one has to learn the nature of chemical language in doing chemical education. Then what is very important is to learn the history of chemistry, because many people have developed the chemical research without this intuitive knowledge that I talked about. Models and modeling in chemical education. Learning chemistry in a laboratory environment, that's very important. Chemistry curriculum for general education, analysis and elements of a design, the roles of chemistry in a vocational education. There are lots of vocational courses where chemistry can have important thing, and generally informal chemical education. The context-based approaches to the teaching of chemistry is extremely important. Although I'm talking of chemistry, but much of it is going to be common. For example, the particular nature of matter. Submicroscopic world, it's there in physics, it's there in biology today. Microscopy is a great tool in biology. The problem solving is also a great tool in all subjects. So I think it's very important to realize that although I'm talking of chemistry in general, the general points are true for all subjects. Chemistry itself is changing. In fact, old days, chemistry was a chemistry of structure. Now, it is going from structure to functions, and this is where biology materials is playing a very important role. So biological activity is determining a structure function, and then we must make a molecule which has that function. And then, so then we have to think in a retro manner from function, in a retrospective manner, from function to do structure, and then look at synthesis. This is where the computational science, as I will show you, is going to play a very, very important role in this retro thinking. We have to also break the traditional barriers of discipline-based chemistry. So we have to go to organic, inorganic, physical, bio. These are all discipline-based, but somehow we have to break these barriers. The research, of course, has to be driven by emerging trends in technology, society, and whatever. So that is very, very important to remember. A historical perspective always helps. And I must say, not just history of chemistry, but history of science should be, I advocate adding history of science as a curriculum in most of the universities, most of the institutions. You learn, how did Archimedes discover? How did Newton discover? How did Einstein discover? Avogadro, Faraday, G.N. Lewis, and so on. In fact, chemistry itself has so many seminal discoveries, like oxygen. Oxygen is a very important discovery. It's the beginning of chemistry. Atomic theory, molecules, Avogadro's law, urea synthesis, I talked about it. Accidental synthesis, benzene, I already talked about it. Dream synthesis from Kekulé. Electrolysis, electrons, radioactivity, plastics, polymers, Bohr theory, chemical bond, and then eventually the quantum theories, which actually had a very deep connection with spectroscopy and connected chemistry with physics in a very big way. The science also will be driven by future challenges, and much of these challenges will require not chemistry, not physics, not biology alone, but an interdisciplinary thought. So much of this will be based on renewable energy. Many laboratories today are working on renewable energy. They are very important. Energy efficient process. So processes which are energy, environment friendly process, green chemistry. With the COVID research, it has become extremely important. You have to have a drug for coronavirus affordable, because a lot of poor people are affected. So to get affordable healthcare is very extremely important. And I tell you, the corona situation is going to give an extreme to the healthcare research. Cultivation of farms, I think all of you us know, this is important. How do you have minimum land water? Because water is always going to be a problem. And maximize crops. Then to have defense systems which are technologically enabled. All these might require expertise of several subjects. I talked of renewable energy. Let me explain renewable energy are basically sustainable resources. What are those? Solar. Remember, India has sufficient solar energy. So can we convert these to heat and electricity? Of course, conversion to heat is something that is happening. Solar to thermal much in a bigger way. What is difficult is solar to electricity to make it cheaper. And any other usable forms of energy, and even chemicals. So this will require subjects like how do you convert, and that conversion essentially brings not just thermodynamics but also the kinetics. So the catalysis becomes extremely important. Wind energy is also a sustainable resource because wind is there. Fuel cell, which works on hydrogen, we can prepare hydrogen. It's not a problem, but hydrogen gives you a lot of energy. So we can actually have a hydrogen energy, and that is fuel cell. Then we have bio waste to alcohols and fuels. So you can take bio materials, convert them into alcohols and fuel. So this is where it's a very good source of renewable energy. Bio waste is continuously coming. So they are all sustainable sources, sorry. Hydrogen I already talked of in the context of fuel cell. Hydrogen is a good source, nuclear energy. And then of course, one renewable source of energy, though not much, is the carbon dioxide to fuel. If you can actually have entire CO2 sequestered into fuels or chemicals, that would be another way to get renewable energy. So there are a lot of sources which people are looking at, and our research, our education must be able to address this. 19, of course, has thrown up several more challenges. One is the research that you want us to do to combat it. we have to worry about how to protect the environment and the climate. We have to bring in technological innovation, more digital education. And of course, for education online, you have to realize that you can do teach anytime, anywhere, anyone, anything. And that is a very, very important learning opportunities that has opened up. Today, as I speak, somebody from California, somebody from New York, somebody from Europe can connect and listen to my talk. So I think that's a very important part to realize that it has opened up tremendous opportunities. Use of technology-enabled tools to replace hands-on experiments in the laboratories, the immediate future need, because we are not able to do experimental labs. So how do you do that? So can you look at IT-enabled tools to replace this? When the COVID will go away and the new normal will start, we will have an opportunity to have lots of innovative solutions. Protection of climate and environment, this is very important. Thrust in research in virology, pharma, in the new normal. We have to develop smart materials which are man-made, but have instincts, have senses of the nature, so that the life becomes easy. Subject communication, innovation and education, I already talked of the laboratory innovation. So that will become very, very important in the new normal. Let me, for the second and the last part, talk about how computational science can integrate. And I dare say the computation is different from theory. So I have a triangle where one side is theory, one side is experiment, one side is computation. But what we require is by combination of these three, a solution. The solution is what is important, and I hope the computational science is going to throw solutions to many of the challenges, many of the problems that I'm going to do. What is important also to realize that even when the COVID virus is there, we can carry on doing computational science. In fact, today, you know, on coronavirus itself, there are so many modeling has taken place. So many, and I'm going to show what kind of things are working is going on. Many simulations just to predict when there will be peak, when the corona will go down. Every day people are analyzing the data. So computation has come in a very big way in the new normal. About the computation, I quote two quotations, one by Quetelet: the more progress science, physical sciences make, the more they tend to enter the domain of mathematics, which is the kind of center to which they all converge. We may even judge the degree of perfection to which a science has arrived by the facility with which it may be submitted to calculation. So it says, if your science is more amenable to mathematics or calculation, it's a good science. So that is where the computational science is coming. In the context of chemistry, however, or biology, it was not understood. In fact, just 2 years after, this is 1828, this is 1830, Comte wrote, every attempt to employ mathematical methods in the study of chemical questions must be considered profoundly irrational, and contrary to the spirit of chemistry. If mathematical analysis should ever hold a prominent place in chemistry, and it says it's an aberration which is happily almost impossible, but if it takes place, it would occasion a rapid and widespread degeneration of that science. And today, of course, we know that Comte is not right. But this was what was thought even 200 years back about chemistry and partly about biology. And today, the computational chemistry and biology have come in a very big way. By using theory, computers, and fast algorithms, we can solve complex equations. We can predict in computers structure and properties of molecules. We can predict reactions between the molecules. And these molecules can be also biological molecules. Structure and properties of virus, for example. So the dynamics of evolution, this is very, very important biology, for biology. How does a system evolve in time? We can model new materials and design drug by, again, computational science. We can actually predict biological activity by, again, computational science. A very important tools that they're using also in biology in particular is the tools of data science, which are called artificial intelligence and machine learning. And I'm sure many of you have heard about these. They will become more and more important in the science research, and even more important in biological research. There are a lot of data in biology. All right, so I think the theoretical chemistry is going to enable this, or theoretical physics is going to enable this. I must say that the modern quantum chemistry is a cornerstone of that. But theoretical chemistry started, the modern theoretical chemistry started even before quantum chemistry. So G.N. Lewis, when quantum chemistry is not there, he talked of octet rule by just number counting, whether there will be bond, what kind of bond, if the molecule is stable or not, and actually didn't require quantum mechanics that time. But today we know that with quantum mechanics, we can explain things. In fact, today we have methods which you call multi-scale methods for different length scale. So for example, if it is an atom or a molecule or a small molecule, we can use quantum mechanics or approximate quantum mechanics, which I call QM prime. At a slightly larger length scale, you can't use quantum mechanics because this is actually a very complex method. We are not going to talk about it, but this requires solution of second order differential equation or multiple variables, which is very hard to do. And no exact solutions are possible. So one has to do approximation, and even they are very, very expensive. So at larger length scale, like for example, proteins, you use what is called the classical approach, where each atom becomes a fundamental particle, and you simply write the energy as a function of the atom-atom interaction. So this is called the molecular mechanics. At even larger length scale, what is called the mesoscopic length scale, you do what is known as coarse grain simulation, and there single atom is also too much. I will show at the end one example of a lipid simulation, where you take a collection of atoms as one bead, and these are called coarse grain beads, and they are interacting among themselves. So the interaction energies are directly programmed, and then one can write. So this makes things much simpler. There are many active groups in India, different length scales, who are now working. But the idea of this kind of transition from one mechanics to another mechanics was actually given by Niels Bohr long back through correspondence principle. When quantum mechanics was started, it says, in the limit, many of you may know, in the limit of Planck's constant going to zero, of course Planck's constant will never become zero because it's a universal constant. So what it means is that in terms of the scales, if h, value of h is almost zero, then the quantum principles will go over to the classical principle. So that's a very famous correspondence principle. So atoms, molecules, and clusters will go to clusters, nano, ball. So this is the bottom-up approach. And that has been one of the cornerstones to define theories at different length scale. This slide is a very, very important slide. It's a busy slide. So I just leave you with this slide for some time. If you look at on the x-axis, this is a length scale. On the y-axis, you have a time scale. So if you have a small length and time scale, we call something called ab initio or first principle theory. These are basically the quantum mechanics. You can do very accurately at a small time for small molecules. If you go to proteins slightly higher, then you do atomistic simulation, which is exactly what I wrote as a molecular mechanics, okay, through force field. If you go to further, then you do coarse graining, where there are beads who are interacting with another bead. And eventually, you have engineering simulation. So computational fluid dynamics, finite element, Brownian dynamics, and so on, cellular automata. That is, let's say, a building. When you are talking of a house, civil engineering structure, you can't imagine that building is a collection of electrons. That's too much. You actually directly use engineering simulation, but they must have connection because building is also made of electrons. So how do I connect one level of theory to another, to another, to another is a big challenge. But today, I have all these materials which are available. So depending on my system, I directly go to the method. But remember, people have to develop the methods. And I dare say that development of methods is very, very important job. And I think as Indians, we have to just use the method. So depending on the method, depending on the system, use the method. This is exactly what is called horses for the courses. It means look at the racing course. You know horse race course, racing course? So look at the racing course and then decide which is better. So depending on, so if I have a protein, I'm going to use molecular mechanics. If I am much bigger than protein like membrane, I probably am going to use coarse grain simulation because even this will become too large. So it's the horses for the courses approach is what we actually take up. But there are very exciting developments which have taken place, which have put two different length scale together in one system. It's not that one, every system has a one system, two different, and these are things that are known as. So there is a virtue of the methods. What is the virtue of quantum mechanics? And explain interactions very nicely. What is the virtue of molecular mechanics? It can explain large systems less, but enough. So if you have a biological systems and you have a drug interacting here, then drug interaction is quantum mechanics. So you cut out this blue quantum mechanics, then you put an interface region, which is the green region, where you do some jugglery so that you don't have a sudden transition from quantum to molecular mechanics. And this third is a large environment that is modeled by classical force field. Simple. Some harmonic terms for bond length, bond angle, dipole angle, and some long range and short range term plus Coulomb interaction and so on. So you have very simple potential which can model these long range interactions. So it's a mixture of the best of everything. Of course, you can also say, why only MM? I can go to coarse grain. Yes, indeed, in one system, you can have QM, oblique MM, oblique CG. So all three methods outside, there can be a coarse graining also. All can be mixed up, and this can become a very good method to look at large systems, biological systems in particular. When you talk of quantum mechanics, I will not go into the details, but I should say, instead of solving the Schrodinger equation, we have another method which is becoming very, very popular, and that is known as the density functional theory, or DFT. This is becoming a method of choice in many of the QM calculations for materials, biology, everywhere, because here you don't have to solve the Schrodinger equation. You can directly express energy in terms of what is known as electron density, which even for protein is a three-dimensional quantity. So you have less number of variables. Of course, there are a lot of problems. I will not go into techniques. Problems are to get a good exchange correlation functionals and so on. I will not go into those details. But I think what I want to tell you that DFT is becoming a very, very popular theory, but it is not always reliable, as can be seen from this slide. This is a slide which tells you experimental and computed enthalpy changes. And you can see these are the experimental numbers. Some methods, which I will not worry about, they are very good methods, as you can see. But DFT, I mean, this is not a good method. This is an okay method. This itself, you can see, sometimes it is very good, sometimes it is not so good. 22, 34, 16. So this is good. This is good. Again, this is not so good. So the reliability of DFT is a problem. And because of the fact that we don't know the exchange and the correlation function. But with all that, DFT is becoming extremely popular. So because of the complexity, DFT is often the method of choice. Otherwise, for small molecules, we know how to build with these methods of second order Euler plusset, couple cluster, etc., how to build very good electronic structure theory. We also do molecular dynamics in a classical sense. Then after we get this potential from the atom-atom force field, we can actually solve Newton's laws to look at the translation of nuclei. So nuclei are much heavier than electrons. So we can actually assume that they are classical particles. So they move by Newton's laws due to the atom-atom interaction. So if you take the atom-atom interaction, like in protein, then it becomes completely classical MD simulation, molecular dynamic simulation, because there is no quantum mechanics. There is no quantum mechanics because here we are not considering electrons explicitly. This can be extended to higher length scale, like meso, with beads replacing atoms. So a bead can also move together. So translational degrees of freedom within the bead is frozen, but the entire bead moves, and that could be also a very good way to do simulation. So mesoscale length scales are classical potential like atom-atom force field, etc. So with an appropriate force field, one can look at systems, and a very common problem is protein folding, polymer dynamics. So people are doing protein folding, polymer dynamics, and so on. By simple classical simulation, one can do a large system. But there are other simulations which are called ab initio and Karpov-Mello, where electrons are explicitly considered through quantum calculation, and these are usually DFT, and then their force on nuclei computed. So atom is divided into electrons and nuclei, and then the nuclei movement is considered classically, and sometimes they move together, electron and nuclei. But what is important is that the electron force on the nuclei is computed quantum mechanically. So there are several ways of doing it. The computational chemistry has also helped us in design of catalyst. The catalyst designing is becoming very, very important. I hope all of you know which is a catalyst. It's to speed up a reaction. So there are a lot of reactions which do not take place simply because the reaction is too slow. So how do you do the catalyst selection? And there are metals which can catalyze, there are organic, there are organometallics, and so on. So the design of catalyst is also, it can be done by computation, and I'm going to give one or two examples from my own work just a few minutes after. So the kind of catalyst that we have worked on is metal clusters, gold and silver, and we have shown, for example, AU8 gold cluster, and these are actually experimentally synthesizable today, is catalytically inert, so it does not do anything. But if you just do one dopant, SiAU7, then it becomes catalytically active. In fact, we have discussed this in terms of the oxidation reaction. Similarly, a pristine cage cluster like AU18 is inert, but if you put a metal inside the cage, they become catalytically active. Hydrogen chemistry of gold and silver cluster, then dinitrogen activation by aluminum cluster, and so on. Boron nitride, dope graphene on aluminum cluster, and so on. So one example I'm going to give you is the pristine gold cluster. And you can see what we can do as a chemist. We are looking at a CO oxidation. So this is the reactant, CO oxidation with AU18. So this is where we start. And then we go to the product where CO2 is formed. Catalyst comes out, right? So that AU18 is separate. But in between, so many things happen. And they are called intermediate or transition state, depending on their energies, depending on the local minimum or maximum. And these transition states are very, very important in terms of reaction rate. Many of you have heard the Arrhenius equation of motion. So if the Arrhenius equation of motion says, if you have a very high activation barrier, then you require high temperature to do it. Essentially, the reaction does not take place. So this is a reaction where the transition barriers are 0.71, 0.45 eV. Okay, not very good. Actually, these are not very good. But if you do the same reaction with a metal, sodium, potassium, magnesium, and calcium, you can see the barriers drop down. Now they're very, very small barriers. So the reaction becomes catalytically feasible. So the CO oxidation reaction, which is difficult with just pristine cluster, can be done by gold cluster. But remember, these are experiments which are not done. These are experiments which are done in computer. And again, repeating, these calculations come only out of computational chemistry or computational science. Another example from my own work, AU2, AU6 and AU8, and oxygen activation. So essential oxygen activation means lengthening the oxygen bond, the dioxygen bond. If you do that with just AU6, AU8, nothing happens. The barrier is too high. As long as I put hydrogen chemistry clusters, AU6H, AU8H, the barrier drops down. In fact, the barrier is almost a barrier-less reaction. O2 can be activated very easily, very quickly. You can see this. So there's a lot of interesting things that you can do in computational chemistry. I'm not going to give too many examples. You can similarly look at the storage of hydrogen, which I told you is a very important material for renewable energy. And we have worked specifically on metal organic framework and magnesium. Both of them by themselves are not good, but by doping, you can typically make them good storage materials. I will not worry about it, how you get the good storage material, but one of the important things about storage is that it should not be very strongly bound, it should not be very weakly bound. So that is where we say 15 to 30 kilojoules per mole energy. There are lots of examples of hydrogen material. Fuel cell, you can see this bus is running on hydrogen, no actual fuel. That's why hydrogen is a fuel. In fact, I myself have got in a London quite some time back a demo bus which was running on hydrogen. I think it was 2012 or 13 on a Piccadilly on a Sunday afternoon. I got into a bus. So the fuel cell is going to become a reality, and many cars will run on hydrogen in the near future, and that will be extremely sustainable because then you don't require the petroleum fuel. I gave an example of an artificial photosynthesis, and this is where synthetic biology, I'll tell you that a little bit about that, is going to play a role. How do I do an artificial synthesis in chemistry lab? That is going to become very important. LED, again, many of these can be computed, many of these can be predicted. LED has the same problem. Silicon is a very poor conductor. If you dope, they become better conductors. You have N-type and P-type semiconductors, and you can see the application of LED. Remote clock, control, digital clock, watches, calculator, everywhere. You cannot think of life today without LED. It's a great discovery. Many of the discoveries that are also taking place have nanomaterials underneath. So nanomaterials, and of course materials, I'll just explain which are of the order of nanometer. But what is important is to understand that it was not even thought that it is possible, because in 1952 Schrodinger had said that one can't play with an atom or a molecule. But look at Feynman's statements. After 8 years, it says plenty of room at the bottom. And of course electron microscopy and fullerenes added to the discovery of nanomaterials. So today many computations are done by nanomaterials. They are becoming the materials of choice, and people can actually use molecular mechanics or force field to design nanomaterials. The theories that I have been discussing so far are all approximations, but they are physics based approximations. So there is some quantum mechanics, be it classical mechanics, there's a physics approach. But there is one more approach which is becoming very important, particularly in biological research, in drug design and many biological research, and that is called the informatics. I must say, so I say there are two phases of computational chemistry, one that I discussed. Another is an informatics. What is informatics? In fact, informatics is used when the problem is very, very difficult to solve. The problem is too difficult to solve at a reasonable cost based on real physics and chemistry. So instead, we use a purely empirical model to predict the required properties. So the fundamental goal of informatics is to represent a phenomena only mathematically, but no, without any physics. So actually, I don't want to understand why it is happening, but I have data. I want to correlate the data and then extrapolate the data to regions of unknowns where I don't know. So it's a completely empirically parameterized equation. There is a mathematics, but no physics. But they have a very high throughput because this can be done very, very quickly. So many times in biological research, the first principle understanding is so difficult that many people resort to informatics. And that is how we have got what is called chemoinformatics or bioinformatics. Many of you know, I'm sure your friends are studying bioinformatics, right? So it's very important to understand bioinformatics. It also calculates molecular properties, biological activity, but without using a physics approach. It's an empirical discipline, using available data to find correlation. And they are particularly used in drug discovery and pharmaceutical research today. In fact, one of the things that has come up very important is called QSAR, quantitative structure activity relationship. It's a very empirical relationship. And just by the available data, we fit, and then we go with the training set, and then we go to unknown. So QSAR is becoming extremely important tool to worry about this. In fact, the data science is also helping the develop these tools. So nanotechnology, of course, I just now said what is nanotechnology is going to become very, very important. So 1 billionth of a meter is a nano. Hydrogen atom is 0.04 nanometer. Just imagine how small is an atom. Because 1 billion meter is already very small. Protein, however, is quite large, 1 to 20 nanometer. A computer chip is 180 nanometer. How small is nanometer? How small is the hydrogen atom? You can understand by looking at a human hair. So the hair that you have on your one hair, single hair, strand of hair, if you pick up, is so thin, but that's a 10 micrometer. 10 micrometer is 10,000 nanometer. So you can imagine how small is a nanometer and how small is a hydrogen atom. It's 1 by 25 of a nanometer. And a nanometer is 1 by 10,000 of a human hair. So considering that, the computer chip is quite big. I think just to give you a perspective, what is nano length? But they are being used for a lot of interesting materials, and they are becoming catalysis. They are basically becoming catalysis that I was discussing, like gold catalyst, silver catalyst. Many reactions are catalyzed by nanomaterials. So I think these are some of the emerging areas. I have already talked about it, but one area I must talk about is synthetic biology. This is becoming extremely important. So what is synthetic biology? Synthetic biology is a combination of chemistry and biology in many ways. So where biologists try to understand the chemistry of the biology, the processes, they try to have a chemical insight. On the other hand, biology does a lot of things effortlessly. So one of the examples I showed is a photosynthesis. The biology does photosynthesis very easily. Plants do it so effortlessly. In the laboratory, if you have to do the same photosynthesis, it's an extremely difficult process. So can I learn from biology and do the chemistry of this? So one is biology learning from chemistry. Another is chemistry learning from biology. And together, it is called synthetic biology. It's a very, very important theme. As you are going for research, you will see we have to be educated. That's what I said, integration of research with education. The education system does not talk of synthetic biology. Then, of course, we have to find out how do you do, what will be the environment after the COVID, the new normal. This is an example of a lipid simulation. Remember, these are all physics, chemistry simulation. I just talked about informatics a little bit briefly. I left the subject of informatics, but informatics is an empirical subject. So there is something that you can understand. But these are all, again, coming back to the theory. So this is a lipid simulation, molecular dynamics, which has 500,000 atoms. But only 36,000 coarse grain beads, because many atoms form a bead. So it was possible to do this simulation in 2007 with a coarse grain bead, not with the 500,000 atoms. That will be too big, even for molecular mechanics. Today, people can start to do 500,000 atoms with bigger computers. But then you can do much bigger system with coarse graining. So again, if coarse graining is good enough, you don't have to do atomistic simulation. Again, horses for the courses approach. So this is just one example I'm giving where people have looked at the lipid simulation. These are some of the work that we are doing in our group. I will end with that. A lot of catalysis. But I want to tell you that when you talk of the lipid, today a lot of people are doing coronavirus. In the same way, you can use simulation completely on the computer to publish on coronavirus. In fact, lots of papers are coming on coronavirus simulation. The dynamics, how it will move. So plenty of things that you can do in biology. Although I must say, in our own group, we have been restricted to chemistry and we have been developing theory. I will not worry about it, particularly of the name that the Dr. Shastri mentioned, the coupled cluster. We have been developing the coupled cluster. We are also developing lots of reactivity of molecules and a lot of work on catalysis, which I mentioned, little bit I mentioned about metal catalyst, hydrogen storage materials, so molecular metal organic framework, and magnesium doped materials. So a lot of interesting things using different types of methods. When you develop, of course, you are developing methods. In these cases, we apply. So we use methods, mainly, again, DFT, density functional theory. I must end the lecture with acknowledgement from various sources, particularly the part that I quoted on the education from Edurams, Kerry, Jakob, etc. It's very interesting to read, particularly about the philosophy of chemistry. And I think those who are interested should do that. Let me end with a thanks to the funding agencies, SERB, Department of Science and Technology, Indo-European Union, CSIR, in the Friends Center, Board of Research in Nuclear Science, DST, DRD, many funding that I have got on my career. Unfortunately, the time was so short that this is not, and this is not probably the time to talk about my own research. So I just talked about very general things, what can be done by computational science, and just give you one slide on my own research, my own group. I have to thank for my own research many of my colleagues, collaborators and students, NCL, IIT Bombay, ISAC Kolkata, currently one collaborator from Pune, another one college, and I'm trying to collaborate with on MD simulation with somebody in NIT Karnataka. I think there is, it's a very good time that we have, and today the collaborations are one way to add value to research. It is very, very hard for every single person to contribute with their own knowledge, singular knowledge or discipline. So I think with that, I hope it was of some help on your summer research training and the lecture. Thank you very much, Dr. Sakya, and thank you to Dr. Sakya and others. And thanks all the participants for listening very patiently, whom I'm not able to see. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful lecture. I think we cannot emphasize more on the point that, you know, along with the fundamental science, application of science is equally important, or if not more than that, so that society as a whole reaps the benefits of science and technology. Thank you so much, sir. And thank you also for highlighting the future challenges and how computational science can play such an integral role for the future of science. And you have given such a whole list of examples. So I think that was the most important part of your lecture. Thank you, sir. And no wonder, sir, we have been receiving a lot of comments from the participants appreciating and complimenting your lecture, mentioning that how informative and useful the lecture is. And along with that, we have also received a lot of questions. So we would like to pose around three to five most relevant questions to you. So we have a team for that, who have been collecting all the questions that we got from MS Teams, Facebook and YouTube. So now I request Ms. Lisa Moni to kindly conduct this Q&A session. Thank you, ma'am. Sir, the first question is the most common question we have received in YouTube. They are asking that why researchers in India mostly prefer to do research in developed countries abroad rather than in India. What is that is lacking in India?
Yeah, it's a very common question and a good question. What is lacking? It's a little bit difficult to say. In terms of research facilities, I would say we're almost to catch up. But then you have to also realize that we have a very heterogeneous system. So all institutions are not equally endowed. So every institution is not good, but the good institutions have caught up. So you might ask the question, why don't you just concentrate instead of going abroad to the good institution? It's a very good point. I think there are two aspects of it. One is, of course, a nationalistic aspect, where I would say, since you have very good facilities, why don't you do work in India? But at the same time, I would say that if you go abroad, if you interact with a separate society, you come to know what they are doing. So that enriches people. So that is definitely one of the reasons people should go abroad. The question is at what stage, how long, that's the question. The second, third aspect is of course an economic aspect, which I believe is less, but when our time, the economic expenses hike, that is, the money for a researcher in India was much less, the facilities were much less, and I think there is a good reason for people to go abroad. Just like that, it happened to Eastern Europe, actually, at that. And then the tradition is now continuing. But if you ask me, technically speaking, I would say in many areas, you don't need to go abroad today to learn. I think we are very good in many areas, but in all the areas. But obviously, there is a history, there is a tradition that people like to follow. And also somehow, it's a little bit of a cultural problem that we also get biased by the people who have worked abroad and so on. The opportunities are also very important. It is in India, it's important to sometimes go abroad, grab the opportunity. India is a complex country. There are so many people passing out and not that many opportunities. So I think there are a number of reasons, I would say.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Anuradha Mitra. She is asking, how are we lacking behind in learning the fundamental sciences due to emerging of applied sciences?
No, I think India was very strong in fundamental sciences, I would say. And you feel that due to the emergence of applied sciences, our fundamental science is reduced. I probably won't agree that has really happened. Maybe in certain places where they have put too much emphasis on applied science, the fundamental science has become very weak. But I think all over the country, I would say there are more people who are working on fundamental science. I would still say that applied science needs much further boost than what it is. But this I agree that it does not any harm the growth of the country.
Okay, sir. The next question is from Madhupriya Selvaras. She is asking that is it possible to get similar results done in reactions from in computational chemistry and those in laboratory? Can I get similar results?
This is a very good question. Very often, experimentally, not sure. So yes, there are many computer experiments or computer simulations or whatever modeling has been done, which has later come out correct by the experiment. So actually, the reality is predicted earlier than experiment. So many of them are actually agree. Many times we agree with the experiment. Many times experiments come later. There are times when there is a discrepancy. I also agree. So that is because sometimes the theories, all the theories we're using are not exact theories. They're approximations. So the approximations we have not used correctly. So that is where the computational science is also being developed regularly. So today we are coming to a stage, I would say in a summary answer, we are coming to a stage where we can begin to feel confident that with computation we can predict the experimental results.
Okay, sir. So the last question is from Ananda Palaji. He is asking that although India has innovative views and is ruling the world of research, but still there are many creative and innovative ideas that cannot enter in the research phase, and not more than 20% of such researchers get recognition. So sir, how can this be enhanced, and how the students can use their research path?
Yeah, so I think certainly a lot of innovation. As I told you, one of the reasons that our innovative mind has not been expressed is because in the education we have been extremely technical, and sometimes education has been very boring. I must say, if I had they do not allow people to think. So the research ability of innovation has not been developed. So that is the reason you don't find many of these innovations entering the researcher space. But certainly the innovative India has an innovative mind. So provided we have proper education system in which entertain, and I didn't talk about much about education, but the real problem with our education is that we are very bookish. So if you write, so I have seen times when students are very good, but that student is not a good researcher, simply because the student is not able to think originally, but can reproduce whatever has been told to them very well. But that is not research. So that thing, and not just reproduce knowledge, what has been transferred, is something that we have to allocate in the education system. So then researchers will suddenly, information is very important.
Thank you, sir. And over to you, ma'am. Thank you, Ms. Lisa. Thank you so much once again, sir, for sparing your valuable time to be with us this afternoon. Thank you, sir, for being so patient in, you know, delivering such an elaborate and informative lecture and in answering all the queries. Thank you once again on behalf of my director and the SRTP team at CSIR NIST. I would like to now request my director, Dr. G. Narahi Sastry, to give his concluding remarks before we close the session. Over to you, sir.
Thanks to all chat messages. I like my talk. Thanks to all of them. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Illika, and thank you very much, Dr. Paul. As usual, a very fantastic overview of what a scientist can do, and giving a different perspectives to various branches which are fortuitously divided, like physics, chemistry, biology, engineering, so on and so forth. And it's really fortunate for all of us that such eminent people are with us, and then you are able to see them talking and get their views. And Professor Paul is also from the same institute where Telkar, who gave the talk a few days back, has come. And it's really very, very nice that these eminent people are taking their time and then answering some of your questions. And also, we have to realize that we have to go a little bit deeper into any branch of science. And once you get to this level of excellence, whether it is basic science or applied science, they all will merge. And the examples are people like Professor Paul, who just started like a theoretician with a lot of in-depth insights into mathematical and physics-based approaches to molecules and materials, has emerged as somebody who has made fundamental contributions not only in basic science but also applied science, and more importantly, providing the leadership to some of the best institutes in the country. On behalf of all of you, I once again thank Professor Paul for kindly accepting our invitation. Thank you, sir. Namaste.
Thank you very much to all of you. Namaste. Thank you. I wish I could come in person, but that's not what it can be now. But thank you very much for inviting me.
This has been a nice lunch. We actually, on behalf of NIST, you can have your own lunch, Dr. Paul.
Thank you very much. And I hope there are people in the NIST. Some people are coming, or is it completely locked?
No, at least about 80% of the people are coming, and then they are doing very good job. Actually, they are working harder in 3-4 different aspects.